Hello, everyone. This is Bobbin Thread Bear, and welcome back to LA Noire. Finally back on to DLC missions here.
You know a Freddy Calhoun?
Sure, I know
Freddy. Freddy needs money to get out of town. Says he's prepared to blow the whistle on a primo reefer distribution ring. Says he
can... Has he said how much it's gonna cost?
$50.
And the department will front me the 50?
You can put in an expense claim. He's over at Mike Lyman's on Hollywood Boulevard. See what you can find out.
That was just pointlessly prickly. I'm trying to talk to him, but...
What now?
If I know Freddy, he'll cut and run if there's even a hint of trouble.
Moving,
we should get
Phelps.
There quick.
Roy's informant is the skittish type.
Yeah, Roy was just telling me, actually. Luckily, there are exit signs everywhere.
$50? Do they think I'm made of money?
No, you just look like you're made of money.
Oh, very good. The kid's on form. I'd say on a scale of dull to scintillating, you're a solid tedious today, which you can be pleased with.
Do you ever listen to yourself?
I don't have the same voices in my head as you do, Cole.
He's got an entirely different ones.
Goddamn captain's making heat at the table.
You're the reason, brothers and
you know the way. You can drive.
That with great care. If communists have attempted to inject their
Someone on the radio ranting about communism. The more things change, the more they stay the same.
There's a little sneak. That's him in the back, Cole.
Would you recommend the special?
Freddy, you're looking good.
You're gonna help me, right?
That's what I'm here for.
You got the money?
The 20? Sure, right here.
20? I said...
You want the money or the alternative?
Tell us about the reefer, Freddy.
Who's he?
Another good Samaritan. Answer the question.
Brass comes from Tijuana. They bring in 50 pounds a week.
50 pounds? Are you hallucinating, Freddy?
Get stashed at a house at 1452 North Las Palmas.
Names, Freddy.
The guy at the house is a spick that goes by the name Juan Garcia Cruz. Be careful. He likes guns. How do I get my money?
Do me a favor, Freddy. Spend the money on a bus ticket. Can't last forever on a snitch jacket. Let's go visit this Cruz character. 50 pounds of dope. Crazy.
You know, he said he would be spending it on a bus ticket. Although, considering he probably has a drug problem, it's not a guarantee that he will.
You're behind the wheel.
Crossfire. Wonder what that's about.
You believe a story? Sure. A hophead like Freddy would raffle his sister for his next score.
Hophead, by the way, that's another term for someone on heroin. What the hell? Like, do they look like cops?
Call for help. I'll try to find a way in.
Or does this guy normally just randomly fire on passers-by? Maybe he recognized Roy Earle? But yeah, there are two guys, and they are They both have submachine guns. They're focused on the front entrance. So going in through the back is a very good idea for not getting hurt. Especially with half his profile out in the exposed like that.
I'll ask you politely to move on. Next time I won't be so nice.
You guys don't half leave a mess. What happened?
Dope peddler, Juan Cruz. You opened fire and, well, the rest of the story tells itself.
Yeah. Yeah, it does.
Silver dollar. I thought they took these things out of circulation.
Kind of looks like they have, based on that stamp on the front.
Juan Garcia Cruz. This is his address, but this place looks like a front.
But yeah, America's been trying to put out dollar coins for decades and decades. It just never takes for some reason. One of those weird things. And yeah, the arms and heads are much less important now that we've moved on to Vice. Plus, we kind of know how this guy died. Yeah, not getting nothing out of that.
Is this a drug or a village in Borneo? It doesn't appear to be in Spanish.
I think that's a backup hint for much later.
Doesn't anyone eat regular meals anymore? Junkies feeding on popcorn and grasshoppers living on soup.
I wonder why the term grasshoppers fell out of favor.
Nope.
These guys sure have one hell of a gun collection.
Optimistic, Paul. What
the hell even is that? I think that covers basically most of the house. Although, there might be something in the kitchen here. No. Nothing in the kitchen but spare beer bottles. So let's check out this shed in the back. Not even check if it's locked, I guess. Corn, or?
No good to me.
Ha! Phelps! You jump like a girl.
Got Earle, too.
Now we're getting somewhere.
More soup? Who in the hell keeps a secret stash of soup?
Yeah, especially with all the soup back in the house, too.
You hungry or something, Phelps?
I'd say that's pretty good value for 12 cents.
Factory sealed. Someone at the cannery has a lot of explaining to do.
By the way, there's this rather odd achievement you can get for opening both of the cans here. Even though, yeah, it's exactly the same as the other one. Like, all the DLC cases have just, like, a couple extra achievements associated with them.
With Juan dead, we need a new suspect, Cole. Is there a pattern to the deliveries?
I'll say.
This guy EJ seems to be bringing in most of the serious weight. Dates and times seem pretty regular. We should notify the border crossing.
Those fuckers are probably in on it. Let's wait and see how this plays out.
Looks like our informant was telling the truth. Well, let's get moving. I'm guessing that guy's already in the stretcher because it's less certain where he would have died as compared to the first guy. Like, most guys just shoot that, the first attacker on the left there. Yeah, also, there's supposed to be a flyer around here somewhere for another destination.
You can drive.
But it's optional, so whatever. We're just skipping it.
Brother says the morphine is still turning up.
Makes sense. We have no idea how much of the stuff Lenny shifted. There's been no comeback from Cohen as yet.
Maybe Confidential Magazine is right, and Bugsy is on the slide.
You read that stuff? I wouldn't say it to his face if I was you. That is one hot-tempered son of a bitch.
Why are they talking about Bugsy Siegel? He's already on the slide. That's why Mickey Cohen's taken over. He's been on the slide. I mean,
right. Let's see if we can find out who's been over-seasoning the soup in this place.
LAPD. Who owns this factory, ma'am?
Mr. Parnell. Howard Parnell. I'll let him know you're here. Please, take a seat.
If you don't mind, we'll come with you.
If you must.
You just wanted a follower, didn't you? You sly dog. I must apologize for my partner's roving eye. He hates saying goodbye, but he loves watching them leave.
Give it a rest, Roy.
If you could show these men in to see Mr. Parnell, Doris. They're from the LAPD.
Follow me, gentlemen.
What is going on?
LAPD, sit tight, fatso. You could be in very serious trouble.
There's no reason to be rude. Take a seat, gentlemen. I'm sure we can sort this all out.
Maybe you can explain why we found $5 bags of marijuana in sealed Parnell soup cans.
That's an outrageous allegation.
How do you explain it, Chubby? We found at least 30 cans, all sealed up tight with your label on it.
Can I get a list of your employees?
Of course. We have nothing to hide. Doris, can you bring me in the current employee listing?
Here it is, Mr. Parnell.
On the desk, please.
Is she flirting with him?
Any name on that list that rings a bell?
No? Ah.
This is familiar. 1452 North Las Palmas, a Jorge Garcia Cruz. The factory-sealed cans we found suggest a very professional operation, Mr. Parnell. We're looking for an inside man.
I know nothing about this. I want this stopped as much as you do.
Tell me what I want to know, Parnell, or I will have half the LAPD down here tearing this place apart. You're hiding something.
Am I right in thinking you would not want to pursue misdemeanors outside your drug case?
Depending on what you call a misdemeanor, we might be prepared to turn a blind eye.
The truth is, I employ a lot of illegals. No one wants to do menial work anymore. Most of my factory staff are wetbacks. The local blacks and Chicanos all want jobs in aircraft factories.
Presumably because the pay is a lot better. How are your sales, Mr. Parnell?
Just fine and dandy, son. We're entering a new era of prosperity. I hope you're both big soup eaters.
Did you notice Roy Earle teleporting just now?
Mr. Parnell, do you know what kind of trouble you're in? Come clean with us.
Okay, so things are a little flat. We're deciding whether to lower production. It's taken a while to adjust to not having any military contracts. You know, we sold Uncle Sam 5 million cans of minestrone.
Ever heard of Juan Garcia Cruz?
Not that I know of.
He has a brother employed here. You know him?
We employ large numbers of Mexicans. I'm not familiar with them all.
That's funny, Parnell. He has the same address as his brother Juan, who we shot dead less than an hour ago. You better give me something.
Look, I'm not involved in this. I'm getting enough grief from Washington. There's an investigation going on into profiteering. Like a guy shouldn't be able to turn a buck while the war is on.
I'm sure thousands of dead Marines sleep soundly knowing that you did okay. Tell us about Jorge Garcia Cruz.
Jorge? I had no idea of his last name. His team does daily maintenance on the conveyor belts and cookers.
You know this fuck and his brother. They're extorting you, and you need to tell the truth.
You're out of your mind if you think a couple of beaners could shake me down. Where is your proof?
Sorry. Sometimes you have to shake the tree to see what falls out.
So he's here now?
No, maintenance is at night. Night shift finishes around midnight. He would usually come in around 9 p.m. and have everything ready for the morning shift at 6.
We'd like to take a look around the factory floor, Mr. Parnell.
I hope we won't have to shut down the line.
No, nothing like that.
Thank you. I'm grateful for that. I'll show you around myself.
I hate seeing how things are made. This is going to be like that time I went to the slaughterhouse and couldn't eat steak for a week.
Well, probably not that bad, because it's just soup, but...
This is where the produce comes in. We peel and sort all of the vegetables and add them to the line in regular quantities.
Fascinating.
Oh, nice reflections.
Why don't you keep quiet? Might learn something.
Oh, good God. This really is turning into some nightmare school trip flashback.
The textures rotate.
This is the hopper, which boils and purees the vegetables. The other hopper is for the pasta. This way, please.
You're loving this, aren't you, Phelps?
Yeah, I think he is.
The soup is ladled automatically into cans. Next stage is labeling.
I'd like to see the packing and dispatch area, if you don't mind.
Sure. It's over here. Follow me.
I get the feeling that this is the designers showing off just as much as Parnell here, the game designers.
This is one of our dispatchers. Sergio, right?
Yes, sir.
These men are from the LAPD. Sergio here records our outgoing deliveries. They all go in the book. Just there, on the desk.
That's disgusting. Did you ever get
it? See, now here it makes sense that everybody's shouting, because it's really loud.
We're looking for repeat business in large amounts, Cole.
What's going on, Parnell? There's enough soup going to this place every day to feed a company of Marines.
What are you talking about?
Can I have a look at that coin?
Sure, why not?
Silver dollar, right?
Yeah, that's right.
The markings on it say it's been taken out of circulation.
Maybe. I'm not trying to buy anything with it. I like it. Brings me luck.
Do you have access to the canning area?
I do. But I keep to my station, loading and unloading. Don't care much for soup.
Stop lying to me. I think you are muling the dope across the border.
I'm a simple working guy caught up in the middle of all this. You're crazy if you think you can prove I drive the truck for these guys.
Well, you're not EJ, so...
Like I made a mistake.
Sergio, if you don't give me something, I'm gonna go to Immigration Services and have you deported.
You get a shipment once every 2 weeks. Ernesto does the driving. I don't know his full name. It's delivered here at night. Jorge gets it canned up. From here, it gets sent all over the country.
What do you know about the 20th century market?
Nada. I get the orders from upstairs. I send the goods where I'm told.
And you don't know Juan Garcia Cruz?
No, not me.
You're a liar, Sergio. You're in it, and I'm gonna break you for it.
You're loco, Placa. I got nothing to do with Juan Garcia.
Well, you sure got his coin in your pocket.
We found a matching silver dollar on Juan Garcia. What are the odds of that, Sergio?
Juan and Jorge aren't brothers. They're cousins. They work for some evil gabacho. The guy is an aberration. He gives out the silver dollars. Jorge gets me a list of deliveries every morning. 20th century is always on.
You keep your mouth shut for today and I'll take you in. Do we have a deal?
Do I have a choice?
Is that a serious question? That's it for now, Sergio. If we need to speak to you again, we'll put in a call to Mr. Parnell.
If you have to, I guess.
We will be in touch, Mr. Parnell. It is imperative that things appear as normal here. Keep an eye on Sergio in case he gets tempted to blow the whistle.
Thanks. I'll do that. You're going to overlook my little immigration problem, aren't you?
Cheer up, Fatso. We're going to let you go on squeezing these poor saps a little while longer. Well... until some commie union types infiltrate this place.
It's an odd threat to make.
I am glad to be out of that place. I never knew fresh vegetables could smell so bad.
Well, it's either because they're halfway to being rotten, or it's all of the industrial machinery.
You drive. Let me go over the case.
How many years have you been in Vice, Roy?
More years than I want to own up to, Phelps.
You have any idea who Rojas was talking about?
The gringo runs the operation? Could be anybody. You don't expect those morons to be running the show, do you? You ask Roas how much a silver dollar was worth, he'd probably say 50 cents.
which time they'll be lodged in a convent school.
Sit tight. Let's take a look at what's going on.
Man, we've got a lot done before 11 a.m.
Either these customers are serious soup lovers, or I think we found our middleman.
Car 11 King to KGPL.
Car 11 King, go ahead.
I'm requesting assistance in a B-Wagon at 20th Century Markets, 1558 North Highland. Numerous narcotic suspects. Code 2 only, no sirens.
11K, roger.
Okay. Cavalry should be here any minute.
Man, one guy was pretty eager to get started.
LAPD, nobody move!
I'll take my chances.
Wow. That's to be the most out-of-shape running suspect I've caught yet.
Whatever you're carrying, hand it over.
Guess he keeps a little for himself.
I'd say he's got about half a can left. I guess that makes me a pessimist.
You can't take me in.
Take you in? Be glad he didn't shoot you. I wouldn't have chased you. If it was up to me, you'd be talking out of a hole in the back of your head.
I want information.
Señor, I would like to help you, but I got a family in Mexico I have to provide for, and my compadres are very unreasonable.
Your compadres? Turn out your pockets. I need Ray to run down these silver dollars.
I need to make a deal. I need guarantees.
You have identification? Sanchez Erto, Mexican, Tijuana address.
I have no idea if that counts as documentation at this point in time.
Here's the deal, Erto. You give me information, and I won't give you to immigration.
Kind of an odd time to rhyme, but okay.
Give me EJ, the driver bringing in the shipments, or I'll make you for it.
I run the shop. That's all I do.
Tell me the goddamn truth. You are in this with the others.
I told you I know them. I told you my family's at risk. What makes me part of their gang?
Your little solidarity silver coins.
You have a silver dollar, Erto, just like Juan. I'm sure Ernesto and the rest have them as well.
The silver dollars are his mark.
Whose? Give me a name.
None of us are allowed to see him. His creatures carry his orders to us. If I gave you his name, I would be buried alongside my wife and children.
If you don't give us something, you will rot in jail while your family starves on the street.
Ernesto Juarez, tonight at 1 a.m. He's bringing the truck into the soup factory. Please help me, sir. Ernesto can be very cruel.
Well, Juarez starts with a J.
Tell me about the soup cans.
The soup is very popular, as you can see.
Seriously, dude.
It's a real funny, wise guy. You want to try saying that again with no teeth?
I get a delivery at 7:30 every other day from the factory. Jorge organizes everything.
We know about Jorge and Juan. Juan is dead. Tell us how you know the Cruz boys.
Ernesto put together this thing. He brought in Juan, Juan brought in Jorge.
I think you're related to the Cruz boys, and that's how this thing got off the ground.
There is no way you can prove that, officer. Do you have our birth certificates?
Honestly, he probably is related to them.
You're off the hook, for now. Continue.
I was already here. Ernesto knows I'm illegal, so he threatened to report me if I didn't help. And the money is good. The gringos and the gringas, they love the reefer.
and I didn't want to have to leave and start again in San Francisco.
You're breaking my heart. You're under arrest, Erto. I'll speak to the DA and see if he will agree to not seize your assets or deport you. That's the best I can do.
And we're really running through the racial epithets in this case, by the way.
Freddie said they were moving 50 pounds a week. That's a lot of soup cans.
I think this is an interstate operation. Moving dope around the country to selected grasshoppers. Local weed gets distributed in the usual way, through Pachuco street punks.
Someone must know something about this drug baron character.
Here they come.
Well, they did basically say this was a distribution racket.
Let them unload the goods first.
Now?
Let's get them.
Now that's a cavalry charge. Also, screw driving, I guess. Because I want to pull a gun out of the back. By the way, the Tommy gun I've got right there, that's another DLC thing, along with the outfits.
Alright, move. Move! Let's go!
Because normally there is a shotgun in the trunk. But you can also get this.
Okay, gentlemen, we'll take the lead, you cover up.
You can also pick this up.
LAPD, put your hands where we can see them! Throw out the guns!
Go, Phil! Get in there!
Someone knocked my hat off.
Are you trying to get yourself killed?
That took care of that guy. Only four targets left, looks like. Three. But yeah, obviously we couldn't appreciate all of the, intricate factory soup designs, motions, while everything's, you know, shut down for the day. Plus we're in the middle of a shootout.
All clear? I think that's the last of them, Cole.
Detectives, found something here you probably want to see.
Oh, hang on. I can pick up my hat again.
Tijuana address. We should see what the Federales have on him.
Ernesto Juarez, EJ. That's the end of him. Sea of grass? I guess that was included for the pun because that doesn't lead anywhere.
$1 per dead man. Doesn't seem like much for a human life.
Also, whoever's doing that stamping did a really terrible job.
God damn. I think we found our stash, Cole. Take a look in these boxes.
Every one of them is a partial stamp.
At the very minimum, another 50 pounds.
Detectives, I think we got the guy. Does the name Cruz mean something to you?
It certainly does.
And by got the guy, what they mean is we have successfully identified one of the bodies.
Yet another silver dollar.
Oh, damn. That is a lot of money.
Must be $1,000 here.
Phelps, Earle, looks like quite a bloodbath. What was this all about?
Drugs and money. What else? Speaking of money, where did that roll go?
I picked it up for safekeeping. The department owes me 50.
Ray, I have another 2 coins for you.
Great. I've got something to show you. It's all set up on the table over here. There. Take a look at these coins you've been collecting.
Apparently, he already knew.
There are letters cut into each coin, along with not legal tender.
Those are Morgan silver dollars from the 20s. They were removed from circulation and sent for disposal. A number of smelters around the country had the contract. Look at them together. Can you work out what it says?
The first coin, MAS. The second, ANG. The third, KAY. The fourth, MET. The fifth, ALS. Masanke Metals.
A metal foundry. Would you like the address?
Would I ever?
1034 Vine Street, Hollywood. We'll finish up here. It's already been a long night, Phelps. See if you can talk them into giving themselves up. You've done the detecting. Now go out and arrest the bad guys.
You can tell by the smirk. He knows how this is going to end. Not even gonna talk to me, huh?
Advice?
Masanke, Cole. That's where the bad guys are. Let's go.
Well, I guess he moved the car up.
I hope that big wad of cash doesn't weigh you down.
Get your priorities straight, Phelps. We're close to bringing in one of the biggest dope cases of the year, and you're worrying about unsubstantial evidence? Straight through the intersection.
Straight through the next intersection.
Almost there now.
Oh, it really is just down the road. Must be how they got the idea to use a soup factory.
Locked. We need another way in.
Actually, from what I've read, there are 2 ways in. One of them involves going up onto the rooftops, crossing from one building to another. The other way is much more direct.
Yep, that'll work.
Although, actually, you know, we're about to go into another shootout. That's pretty much guaranteed, so I'd like to pull out a long arm from the trunk, but apparently it's not going to let me. Oh well.
Full house. King's over.
Cover the back door, Roy.
God damn it! You win one more hand, Andy. I'm taking my money and going home.
Okay, well, now that we're in a guns-out situation, maybe now let me double back and pick out something appropriate from the back here. Yeah, and here's how it works. How you can select between the 2 options. Alright. Now let's start gunning people down. Like the LA cops we are. Oh good, they're clumped together. No one's gonna fire back? Oh, there we go. I think that one guy was just sort of hiding behind the bodies of his dead friends.
You okay?
I'll tell you when I see what's waiting for us at the top.
Throw out the gun!
Or don't. See if I care. Some dirty ass glass. Yeah, I am definitely glad I took the Tommy gun along with me for this one. Man, look at all these people. What's this? You want to flank me? Yeah, that ain't happening. Alright, anybody left alive around here?
LAPD, hands up!
Victor Sanders.
You know this guy?
I should have known.
Of course I know Roy. Roy and I have had an arrangement for many years.
You're under arrest.
Am I?
We have a mountain of prima facie evidence, as well as the testimony.
You'd be surprised how things have a habit of sorting themselves out. Evidence disappearing. Witnesses that can't be found. Policemen that forget. The impossible becomes probable when you have a client list like mine.
Shut your mouth! Turn around and put your hands behind your back.
Guess he's a drug dealer to the stars.
Working vice can be a thankless task, Phelps. But on behalf of the brass and the moms and dads and the concerned citizens, I'd like to commend you and your partner for smashing this dope ring. Reefer is almost as big a threat to the children of this city as communism.
What about Sanders, Lieutenant?
Leave Sanders to me, Phelps. The chief will be looking after that one personally.
He will be brought to trial.
Phelps, we are celebrating your success. Don't push your luck. Sanders is no longer your problem.
Yeah, just in case you were wondering if Roy Earle there was an aberration or an aspect of the system, it's the last one. Once again, all the Mexicans go to jail or the morgue, and the white guy goes free.
Your platoon is what remains of recon. I'm folding you into the 22nd. You'll be going up that damn hill tonight.
We're intelligence gathering, sir.
I don't need intelligence, son. I need men who can hold rifles and kill Japs. Tonight, you're a rifle company. We've got cooks, mechanics, and stretcher bearers all going into the line. We aim to break them tonight, Lieutenant.
Good to see you, Hank.
You too, Cole. How's your war?
Not quite what I expected.
As long as I live, I will never get over that sound.
Hey, who's that medic? He'll be killed going out there.
It's Sheldon, the guy from the Asakawa Bridge. That guy's got no fear.
Yeah,
He didn't make it.
I didn't go out there to save him.
What are you saying, man?
I went out there to put him out of his misery, to ease his pain. Do you have a problem with that?
Murder, Corman.
That's war, Lieutenant. Smell the stench. Feel the whore's breath on your neck.
You need help, man.
Call for me tonight, Lieutenant. When you're up on that hill. I've been up there 3 times already. The circles of hell have nothing on Sugarloaf Hill.
Get this madman out of my sight!
You know, to be fair to Cole, he is kind of going apocalypse now there. For today's film, I am not going to cover Reefer Madness. It is a classic, but for all the wrong reasons. Besides, I did a drug-filled last time. So instead, I'm going to be doing a gangster film. It's not Little Caesar, because I didn't actually notice the connection until recently. Silly of me, I know. But it is part of the original gangster film trilogy, of which Little Caesar was also one. I'm speaking of the original 1932 Scarface. The story about the story. Prohibition rendered the manufacture, transportation, and sale of alcohol illegal, or at least mostly illegal. It was still used for medical purposes, and many a lush resorted to chugging a bottle of pure ethanol during the 1920s. The intent of the constitutional amendment was to reduce crime and immorality by making it harder for people to indulge their alcoholism, but it actually led to a rapid increase in both. Turns out making a product illegal doesn't make demand for it go away, and demand for alcohol was so high that it made a lot of criminals immensely wealthy and gave them that much more power and influence over society. Major American cities became bloodbaths, as gangs vied for power while the local cops either stood to one side or joined the gang's payrolls. The Great Depression, which started a decade later, didn't help matters either. Suddenly, there were a lot of unemployed people running around, desperate for work, for money, for food, for any way to keep themselves and their families alive. They managed to avoid a famine, even with the Dust Bowl raging thanks to massive public spending and farm subsidies, but the unemployment problem led a lot of desperate people to roam the countryside robbing stores and banks. And it led a lot of other people to commiserate more with the robber than with the lucky stiffs who have a steady job, and the financial institutions who were to blame for the whole mess in the first place. It's no wonder, then, that the first generation of talkie films, which came out in the early 30s, featured a lot of movies where the gangsters were the protagonists. That's not to say the gangsters were the heroes, or that they got to get away with their crime. They do some pretty horrendous stuff, and even without the censorship boards interfering, it's a long-standing convention for evil people to get their just desserts before the story's end. But at the same time, the renegade cut a particularly sympathetic figure in the 1930s. Scarface has the distinction of being a Howard Hughes production, with Howard Hawks as the director. Aside from being a larger-than-life figure during the early days of aviation, Hughes was also a major figure in the film industry, starting long before he bought RKO in 1948. He produced independent movies, starting in 1928, including Hell's Angels and Scarface, which means we are once again looking at a United Artists production. Scarface ran into a couple of hurdles during its production. See, the protagonist, Tony Camonte, is loosely based on the life and times of Al Capone, Chicago's most famous gang boss and a man who still wielded significant power in 1932. The way the story goes, Capone sent a couple of his boys to talk to the film's lead screenwriter, Ben Hecht. But Hecht's old career was a journalist on the crime beat in Chicago, and he wound up talking the two men into acting as consultants for the movie instead. The incident may be apocryphal, but it's still one hell of a story. On the other hand, the other major snag got plenty of press. The New York Censorship Board, widely considered the most important of its time, objected to Scarface, particularly the ending, and so Hughes went back into production and recut the ending to make Camonte less sympathetic and to portray his trial and execution. However, the censorship board still objected and still refused to sign off on Scarface. In response, Hughes reverted to the original ending and then released the film in every other state. Those states that also had censorship boards recut the movie to different degrees, and we're lucky that the original cut existed when the film was re-released in 1979 because, boy, there were a lot of variations. As it is, the cut you can see today still has more than a few elements which are obviously there to appease the censors. See if you can spot them. The story. The movie begins with an indictment of the government and of the public, which presumably has some influence over the government. With that bit of preachiness over, we actually start with a man cleaning up after a rowdy stag party. Big Louis Castillo is a man who's on top of the world and enjoying every moment of it. And although he apparently runs the Chicago Italian Mafia, he's willing enough to let the other boys have their slice of the pie. Unfortunately, not everyone shares his generosity, and the shadow of a man saunters in with a whistle, says, "Hello, Louis," and shoots the man dead. Note the cross in the window, by the way. It's going to be a running motif. We next move to a newspaper office, where the editor-in-chief exposits that Castillo was the last of the old mob bosses. And with him gone, there's going to be a gang war, as every mug with a gun tries to take his place. After that, we visit a barber shop, and a man with his face covered has the barber hide his gun when his buddy at the window, little boy Ronaldo, warns him the cops are coming. Sure enough, there's a detective who wants to bring the two men in, and we then get our first good look at Tony Camonte, who has a very prominent scar on his left cheek in the shape of a cross. Tony has no respect for the police, a fact which leads the officer to deck him one, but Tony goes quietly anyway. The cops go over Tony's history when he's down at the department, which includes a move from New York City and the fact that he was Louis Castillo's bodyguard. They accuse him of killing Castillo for Johnny Lovo, Castillo's rival, but Tony doesn't talk. The angry cop from earlier prepares to take Tony away and start working him over, but before he can, Lovo's lawyer shows up with a writ of habeas corpus. For reference, that's legalese for either charge this person or release them. Since the police don't have enough evidence to charge Tony, they have to let him go. Tony heads over to Lovo's place, which is where he's laying low until the heat dies down. While he's there, Tony admires Johnny's apartment, his silk robe, and his girlfriend, Poppy. For her part, Poppy is rather unimpressed with Tony, but Lovo is, and he gives Tony a cash payout, a raise, and a promise of even more to come once the two men take over Southside Chicago. Tony suggests expanding into the north too, but Lovo orders him not to, since O'Hara and the Irish mob are too powerful to tangle with, for now. Later, in a taxi, Tony pays Ronaldo for being his lookout and explains that he's got some real ambition. And while Lovo is running things today, someday soon, Tony is going to be the biggest of them all. That evening, Tony has dinner with his family and complains about how his sister, Cheska, never comes home on time. When he hears a noise out in the hallway, he discovers her making out with some guy and chases him out. Tony shouts at her, saying he doesn't like anybody kissing his sister. And Cheska implies that he may have more than just brotherly affection for her. By the way, the incest implications here were apparently more obvious in the original script, but Hawks toned it down even before production began since he knew there was no way it would fly past the censorship boards. Tony proceeds to buy back Cheska's favor with some of the money he got earlier. When his mother sees this, she tells Cheska to give it back, and says that her son is no good. For her part, Cheska doesn't care, and she goes up to the window in her room to flirt with Ronaldo, who's sitting outside. Some days pass, and Tony and Lovo go to Castillo's old social club where all the Southside gang leaders have gathered for a meeting. Lovo lays it out for them. He's going to be the new boss and turn the Southside into one big organization. When one of the men tells him off and tries to leave, Tony steps up and beats the crap out of him. One of the other men points out that the biggest Southside operations aren't present and aren't about to go along quietly, so Lovo tells him that he'll be pushing them out of business, and Tony will be doing the pushing. What follows is an extended sequence where Tony strong-arms the speakeasies of Chicago into buying their beer from Lovo. Sometimes this involves intimidation, and sometimes it involves throwing bombs through windows, or shooting the place up. The morning after, Tony meets with his boss and tells him how he both started and finished things the night before. But one of the bosses, Meehan, lived. So Tony goes to the hospital and kills Meehan there. Note the cross in the window again, by the way. Time passes, and Tony's got himself new suits, a new bulletproof car, a new place, and a lot of jewelry, which was considered effeminate at the time, but is accurate to Al Capone's personal tastes. Tony is also trying to get Poppy's attention, and while she's more impressed with him now, she still dismisses it. Tony then goes to speak with Lovo, who's upset that Tony's moving into O'Hara's territory. Lovo gets ready to do some damage control, but as they leave the club, a car speeds by and dumps a body with the words "Keep out of the North Side" pinned to it. We then get a rather out-of-place vaudeville bit, where Camonte's new secretary, Angelo, is too incompetent to get the name of a guy on the phone. Poppy then stops by for a visit, and Camonte shows off the steel shutters on his windows, even as he obliquely brags about killing O'Hara and his flower shop. He also shows her the sign across the street that says, "The world is yours." He also talks about having the money for luxuries, like wearing a different shirt each day, and sleeping on a spring mattress. As the police try and fail again to get something to stick to Camonte, we meet the new boss of the North Side, Gaffney, played by Boris Karloff. He's bought up dozens of Tommy guns, and as soon as he hears where Camonte will be eating lunch, he leads a long line of cars and shoots the place to hell. Angelo does another vaudeville bit while this is going on, and Camonte not only survives, he manages to get one of the submachine guns, and he talks about how he's going to get some more and change everything. When he gets back to the club, Lovo is furious. O'Hara's men came by there, too, and Lovo got clipped in the arm. He demands that Tony stop. Instead, Tony uses his new Tommy gun to go on a killing spree, shooting up Northside targets in a series of drive-by attacks. The police, meanwhile, can do little to stop the violence. Oh, and look, there's another cross. In fact, there are quite a few during this sequence. And for the St. Valentine's Day massacre, which actually happened and involved Capone's men dressing up like cops and mowing down 7 rivals all at once, well, there are 7 crosses on the screen. Gaffney was supposed to be there at the time of the massacre, but he was late and managed to avoid it. He goes into hiding, but that cross on the wall behind him doesn't bode well. The movie then interrupts itself right in the middle of the action to essentially justify its own existence. We're in this random newspaper guy's office, where somebody objects to all the publicity gangsters are getting, and in response, the guy yells at the camera for 4 minutes about how the only way to get rid of gangs is to make sure the public knows what they're doing. We now return you to your gangster movie, already in progress. Camonte has found out that Gafferty is out bowling, and although he has to leave a play early to do it, he shoots Gafferty down. In this case, by the way, the cross is the one you get for bowling a strike. Flush with victory, Tony goes to see Lovo and Poppy at an upscale restaurant. Notably, both men offer Poppy a light for her cigarette, and she chooses Tony's. Meanwhile, Tony's sister is coming on strong to Ronaldo, who's too worried about Tony's reaction to accept her advances. With good reason, too, so she goes off with some random guy to dance, and Tony starts wailing on him. After he takes Jessica home, some goons in a car try to mow Tony down, but he ducks into his bulletproof car and begins an extended chase sequence. In the end, both cars go over a cliff, but Tony manages to survive and makes his way to the closed Italian restaurant. Tony makes a few calls and tracks down Ronaldo at one of his girlfriend's apartments, and together they come up with a plan. The restaurant's owner, Pietro, will call Lovo later that night, pretending to be one of the men in the other car, and he'll say the car got smashed and Tony got away. Meanwhile, Tony and Rinalda will be there to see how Lovo reacts. Sure enough, when Pietro calls, Lovo acts like it's a wrong number. When Tony starts whistling, Lovo knows the jig is up. Tony punches Lovo's name out of the glass, and Lovo starts begging for his life. Tony decides to let Rinaldo have the final word in this case, and I believe the cross for this scene is the window to the left and the fan to the right, which you can see on Tony's close-up shots. With Lovo dead, Tony goes to Poppy's to bring her to his place, and afterwards takes a moment to admire that sign from before. Tony leaves town for a month, and while he's gone, his sister finally gets Rinaldo to bite. When Tony gets back, all he hears from his mother is that Cesca has a new place and is meeting with a man there. And as you might expect, this makes Tony furious. When Tony reaches the apartment, marked by an X, and Rinaldo opens the door, he doesn't wait for an explanation, but just opens up on the poor guy. In tears, Cesca tells Tony that the two of them married yesterday, tells him they were settling down together. And for what may be the first time in his life, Tony regrets having murdered someone. Cesca goes to the cops, finally giving them a way to put Tony away for good. And they start shooting at Tony just after he gets home. The comic secretary, Angelo, gets a couple bullets in his stomach and manages one last tragic reprisal of his vaudeville routine. It's Poppy who's called, but Tony isn't interested. Cesca then shows up with a gun and almost shoots Tony, but she eventually decides not to. They're ultimately the same person, she says, so it would be like shooting herself. The police arrive in force and lay siege to Tony's place, and both he and Cesca start getting out the guns and closing the steel shutters. Unfortunately, Cesca catches a stray bullet before Tony can cover all the windows, and the two of them have a remarkably touching death scene. A tear gas grenade interrupts Tony and forces him out of the room, and when the police break down the front door and shoot the gun out of his hand, Tony starts begging for his life, just like all the others. Rather than go quietly, however, Tony makes a break for it and gets shot down by the police. The last shot of the movie is that sign again. The world is yours. Final thoughts. It all comes back around to censorship in the end, doesn't it? Almost every last film I've spotlighted was affected by it. Columbo wasn't a film, but as a network TV show, there were some hard limits on what they could show, what they could do, and what they could say. The Maltese Falcon removed or tried to remove the homosexual subtext surrounding Cairo and Gutman. In The Big Sleep, the director had to add basically a throwaway line at the end, which implied that the mob boss, Eddie, killed Regan instead of Carmen, which is how it was in the book. In Rebel Without a Cause, Plato clearly and knowingly shoots at Jim Stark, but they had to add a line where he says he was confused. The Postman Always Rings Twice sat on a shelf for over 10 years because of censorship fears. And James Cagney added that unusually close mother-son relationship mostly to see what the censors would do about it. Intolerance was a 3-hour screed against censorship. And the ending to DOA had a Greedo shot first situation, which had no reason to exist except to avoid casting even the shadow of villainy on the protagonist. A Streetcar Named Desire also had to remove all references to homosexuality, and the two henchmen in The Big Combo probably could have been more open about themselves in a different era. Double Indemnity struggled to get made because of censorship. Psycho demonstrated censorship's failing power, and The Man with the Golden Arm was a deliberate act of defiance. And today's film, Scarface, wasn't just changed for the sake of meeting censorship standards, it was held up by the proponents of censorship as an example of the reason why films should be censored. And when it was re-released in the 1970s, do you know what rating it got? PG. A flat PG. The 1983 remake of Scarface wasn't just an updated version of the same film. it was an opportunity for Brian De Palma and Oliver Stone to pull out all the stops that Howard Hughes and Howard Hawks had to leave in place. It was a celebration of the end of the censorship era, a celebration that this series won't be experiencing for many weeks to come. Thanks for joining me again for today's film review, and I hope you'll join me next time for my second real-time movie. This one is about a boxer, his final match, and the setup that makes everything go screwy.